on behalf of the Vice Chancellor, Lagos State University, Professor Olanrewaju Adigun Fagbohun, SANNPOM, I welcome you most sincerely to week 9. The course for today is AC812 and AC912. AC812 for the master students and ACE912 for the doctoral students, advanced trends in STEM education and graduate seminar. We have in class today 88 masters and doctoral students from Nigeria and facilitators from Nigeria, from Burundi, from Ghana, from DRC, and from Sierra Leone. We have as our agenda for today a short welcome, which I'm giving now, and I will introduce our special guests of honor. We have two of them for today. The first is Her Excellency Stamenka Vallestrombich. I will introduce her in a moment. And you know, by protocol, the minister speaks last. After the minister has spoken, nobody else speaks. So the minister, His Excellency Professor Gaspard Banyankibona, will give us his opening remarks, after which we'll then take on the lectures. As we are well aware, after the special guests have given us their remarks, they may wish to stay or, because of their busy schedule, maybe leave. But if they stay, we'll ask them at the end of a particular lecture to present the plaque to the lecturers. Your Excellencies, distinguished students, ladies and gentlemen, it's now my pleasure on your behalf, on behalf of our Vice Chancellor, Professor Olanrewaju Adigun Fagbohun, to welcome My Excellency Stamenka Vallestrombich. By way of a short, very short introduction, Her Excellency Stamenka Vallestrombich served as Secretary General of the Association of Universities of Yugoslavia. She began a 20-year career in UNESCO, working in its European Center for Higher Education, CEPES, in Bucharest, before moving to Paris to lead its global work on higher education reform, innovation, and quality assurance as Chief of Section for Higher Education. I'm happy to tell you that Her Excellency Stamenka Vallestrombich led the world in reformatting higher education, and her giant strides on that terrain has been difficult to match. She has facilitated numerous international collaborative projects, such as the Lisbon Recognition Convention, UNESCO OECD Guidelines for Quality Provision for Cross-Border Higher Education, the UNESCO World Bank Capacity Building for Quality Assurance Initiative, and she served as Executive Secretary to the 2009 World Conference on Higher Education. Her Excellency Stamenka Vallestrombich is now Senior Advisor for International Affairs. That's a very important global position, although it is for the chair, that's Council for Higher Education Accreditation of the U.S. But our position as senior advisor is impacting on the whole world. International Quality Group, a member of the International Advisory Board of the Shanghai Jiaotong Rankings of World Universities, ARWU, and consultant to UNESCO. It's my pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, to invite Her Excellency Stamenka Vallestrombich to give her opening remarks. Over to you, Your Excellency.
Thank you very much, Professor Okebukola. Honorable Minister, dear participants and students of Master's and doctoral courses and facilitators from all over Africa. I bring you greetings from Paris, France, which is where I live, despite the fact that I do work with GIAD in the United States, as Professor Okebukola has mentioned in his very generous introduction. It is a beautiful morning in Paris. It is sunny, and we have started deconfining, which is unlocking. So this is also a very special day, meaning that all restaurants are open, but only the terraces. Just as you, most of universities all around the world are not yet opening up. Some may open their campuses, but it is likely that some of them will remain online for a long, long time. So some consider that this is a crisis, but it is also an opportunity, and your courses seem to be such an opportunity because it is wonderful to see you all and so many attending this course, including my colleague from UNESCO, Juma Shabani. I'm special little wave for him. So and other people whom I know, so I greet you. I call this the year of living virtually, and there are certainly some advantages to that, although we will all be happy to return to our normal activities when the time comes. Unfortunately, it is not yet here. I really commend Professor Okebukola and all the organizers of these courses, because these days we all participate in different webinars or write articles about the challenges of COVID for higher education. There are numerous articles and discussions about going online, but for me, I'm particularly excited to be part of a real event and see it happening in real life and not just talk about it. So I thank for this opportunity, and I also wish you a great day. It is one in a series, so a lot of success to you, and have a wonderful two lectures, which I'm sure you're looking forward to. So good morning from Paris, and bye-bye from Paris. Have a wonderful day and have a wonderful lecture.
Thank you so very much, Stamenka. So let us applaud, although I've muted you all, but you all applaud Stamenka Valistrumbich for that wonderful special remarks that he has given to us. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, we are going on to welcome His Excellency Professor Gaspard Bayankimbona, who is the Honorable Minister for Higher Education and Scientific Research of a great country, Burundi. As I stated, he is currently the Minister of Higher Education and Scientific Research, Republic of Burundi. Professor Gaspard Bayankimbona had his university education at the University of Burundi and later in Belgium, where he specialized in aquaculture at the University of Liège in 2006, and a PhD degree in sciences at the Catholic Université Louvain in 2012. His Excellency Professor Bayankimbona is a globally renowned scholar with specialization in ecology and conservation of fish. I'm sure that Professor Shiwa Akindola will be so delighted to hear that. Laboratory of Diversity, Ecology and Environment. He was elected head of the Department of Biology at the Faculty of Science of the University of Burundi, and he served between December 2012 up to May 2013. He was permanent secretary in the Ministry of Higher Education and Scientific Research until December 2014. And then he became the vice chancellor, vice chancellor equivalent of the University of Burundi until April 19th, when he was appointed Minister of Higher Education and Scientific Research. I'm glad to let you know that His Excellency Professor Bayankimbona has made several important reforms in higher education in Burundi that's affecting the entire Burundi and the whole of the Eastern Africa sub-region in one form or the other. One of the projects that we are collaborating, that's the Okeke Global Science Foundation and some allies are collaborating with him, is the establishment of a one-of-a-kind virtual library, digital library, that will be one of the best around. I'm happy to let the His Excellency the Minister know that we are well advanced in this project, and that by God's special grace, before the middle of July, you can even set the date, Your Excellency, for formal launch of that virtual library. Because Professor Juma Shabani, who is leading the Air Force with us, has been quite forthcoming in this. He has been a member of the boards of several national and international academic institutions, including the Inter-University Council for East Africa, and has been a delegate of Burundi to UNESCO's General Conferences since 2012. He is now the president of the Burundi National Commission for UNESCO. It's now my pleasure to invite His Excellency Professor Gaspard Banyankibona to give us his remarks as our special guest of honor. Over to you, Your Excellency.
Thank you, Professor Okebukola. Dear guests of Protocol Observe, ladies and gentlemen, let me start my short address by conveying the greetings from the people of Burundi to you all. It is my honor and privilege to be invited to interact with you this morning on the occasion of this series of online courses offered by LASU, Lagos State University, Africa Center of Excellency for Innovative and Transformative STEM Education. Allow me, Professor, to sincerely congratulate you and the entire team of the Lagos State University and your partners for this initiative and for selecting high-level facilitators from Nigeria, Ghana, Sierra Leone, Burundi, USA and UK, and probably more. The success of these online courses is a proof of a true leadership from you and from the host university. Many thanks to facilitators who have generously accepted their expertise and experiences with African masters and doctoral students in order to provide them with high quality training. You know, Professor, we ventured in the doctoral school of the University of Burundi with Professor Juma Shabani in 2017. And you were one of our keynote speakers, I remember, at the launching conference.
Yes, sir.
We are now comfortable with that investment. And the doctoral school of the University of Burundi is fully benefiting from these unique courses. So I will take this opportunity to thank once again you, Professor Okebukola, for the courses you provided to our doctoral students for the 2 years, especially in a relevant course, use of ICT in the doctoral research process, from title to basis, a course that appeared to be critical for our PhD students to engage in quality research work. So, Professor, to conclude, I would like to appreciate the role of the Lagos State University through the Africa Center of Excellence for Innovative and Transformative STEM Education. And more, I look forward to continuing and strengthening this kind of cooperation between African universities to enable Africa to produce world-class doctoral students. So thank you so much, and may God bless you.
Wow, thank you so very much. I think we need to give a round of applause to our minister. We deeply appreciate your honorable minister. We deeply appreciate your words of encouragement and the exciting words that you have given to us as we push ahead with this effort. So We wish you well too, the Honorable Minister. Please, as I mentioned to you, we are going to have the virtual library of in Burundi, you know, all set to roll before on or before the middle of July. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's collectively give a round of applause to our two special guests of honor for the wonderful work that they are doing. Your Excellencies, you are getting appreciation from Nigerian scholars, from rectors of vice chancellors from all over Africa, from people, scholars from Burundi, from DRC, from Sierra Leone. I can see Freda Wa there smiling from Ghana. I'd like to let you know that you are the number one university in Nigeria, the premier, that's the first university in Nigeria, University of Ibadan. We have the vice chancellor also here, as well as the vice chancellor from the Taisholari University of Education. That is the second university of education in the whole of Africa. The vice chancellor is here. So we are going to proceed with our lecture. We're going to welcome our first facilitator for our first lecture. And that is Emeritus Professor Nimi Briggs. But who is Emeritus Professor Nimi Briggs? He is a graduate of medicine as well as doctorate of medicine of the University of Lagos in Nigeria. And he carries the status of distinguished alumnus of the university. He is a fellow of the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, London, Academy of Science Nigeria, Postgraduate Medical College of Nigeria, and the West African College of Surgeons. Professor Briggs, Emeritus Professor Briggs, is widely traveled and published with research interests in mechanical difficulties in labor, as well as gynecological oncology. He has participated in several collaborative research with leading universities. He served in several responsible positions, such as the Vice Chancellorship of the University of Port Harcourt. Let me pause here to let us all know that while I was serving as the Executive Secretary of National Universities Commission, we instituted an award, a national award for the best Vice Chancellor, second best and third best. And we brought in experts who were former Vice Chancellors themselves from all over the world and chaired by a scholar and university administrator of no mean repute, Professor Akinkugbe, and we reviewed submissions and made all manner of investigations. And we that year in 2003, Professor Nimi Briggs emerged the best vice chancellor in the Nigerian university system. I can see you are giving a round of applause there. He was chairmanship of the boards of the National Hospital, Abuja, and the University of Benin Teaching Hospital. He's pro-chancellor, chairman of council of the Federal University, Lokoja, and Bayelsa Medical University. He's currently emeritus professor of obstetrics and gynecology at the University of Port Harcourt. And as you can see, Professor Nimi Briggs straddles two worlds, the world of medicine and the world of higher education. So he's a strong advocate for quality higher education in Africa. It's now my pleasure to invite Professor Nimi Briggs to deliver his lecture on recent developments in medical sciences, implications for STEM teacher education. Over to you, sir, Professor Nimi Briggs.
Then let me see if I can share my screen. Who's disabled participant screen? How do I thank everybody for this assemblage? I want to welcome, join others in welcoming the Honorable Minister from Burundi. I haven't been to Burundi, but I've met Juma Shabani, and if Juma, is it coming on? Are you bringing it on?
No, we are waiting for you to share your screen, sir.
Well, okay, I have struggled on this now. Okay, let's see. There we are. Can you see? Can you hear me?
Oh, yes. Loud and clear.
And you can see also.
Oh, yes, we can.
I was welcoming the Honorable Minister from Burundi and to tell him that Juma, whom I've met, is a fine gentleman. And I applaud the country for producing a fine gentleman like him. Mr. Manka, I don't know if you remember, I was in your office several times when I was in UNESCO in Paris, and we held a couple of meetings in their office. I also wish to thank Lagos University. I knew that university at its inception because one of our very senior colleagues, Olumide, Olumide, was the pioneer vice chancellor. He was a gastroenterological surgeon, and he established that university. And I'm pleased to know that that university has done very well. It has progressed in leaps and bounds. Of course, I'm not surprised. It has had leadership all along. And of course, it has a formidable human being like Professor Kubikola, who is more than one man in any place where he is. And I'm glad that he continues to make very important contributions to that. I also welcome all the participants. You're having a wonderful opportunity. And I do hope that you will take to heart the things that you're learning in this course. When you talk about recent advances in medical sciences, what are the implications for STEM education? You know, a lot of you know about the Negroes, there is a lot of upheaval, even now, in America. And oppression in America didn't start today. It's been there for a long, long time on the blacks. And the Negroes, when they were oppressed in those days, they sang a lot. They had a popular series of songs they called Negro Spirituals. And one of these Negro Spirituals that I liked is a song called Give Me the Old Time Religion. It is good enough for me. Give me the old time religion is good enough for me. I'm using in this case as a metaphor for a course called Hygiene and Nature Study, which I studied in my early years in the primary school. And I got to know eventually that hygiene and nature studies is indeed the foundation for medicine and formal studies in science. If you go back, if you had the opportunity, if you were lucky enough to have studied hygiene and nature studies, and you went back, to remember that hygiene was both taught in the class and it was practical also outside the class. Outside the class, the teachers looked at your fingers, they looked at your toenails, they looked at your teeth, they taught you to wash your hands regularly, they looked at your clothes. And if you look at all the items I have in red here, washing of hands, disposing of body effluents properly and all that, you will find that this old-time religion we're talking about of hygiene is what we are currently using now to fight our COVID-19 world war.
Oh, yes.
These are the signals open to us now to fight the COVID-19 war. Old-time religion that we've always had is what we are using. And it's not finished if you look at the issue of hand washing still. If you go back, this gentleman here, Philip Semmelweis, Ingersoll Semmelweis, was a physician in Hungary, prepared in Hungary. And in the hospital where he was, he noticed that a lot of women after delivery died when doctors came to attend to them. They died. And he was wondering what was the cause. And he postulated that it must be that a lot of these doctors were not washing their hands after they had dealt with cadavers and gone to other sections of the hospital that were dirty. And they postulated that something on their hands was making these women die. Of course, they cast him away as a madman, put him into some form, and he eventually died there. But eventually, it was discovered that he was right. It was germs on the hands of these persons. And hand washing became a routine in that hospital. Hand washing became a routine in that hospital, and the women didn't die anymore. And it was not better known as savior mothers. From that sense, the issue of hand washing, sanitizers, antiseptics, and all that now came in. And this is it, that advances in medicine prove basic concept. Right now, there is a university in its name, Budapest, to show that. Talking about advances in medical sciences, there are so many. that we'll spend virtually the whole day talking about that. Shall we talk about things? Shall we talk about telehealth, antibiotics, artificial intelligence? You can go on and on and on. What we should do is just to look at a few of them. And even before we go on, we could ask ourselves, why do you wish to teach advances in medical science in a study that is for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics? Why? Well, there are so many reasons, and I've just stated four here. I stated that because health, which is the principal remit of medical sciences, is a fundamental requirement that is similar to health is number one resource and capital for daily living and development. You can't live properly, you cannot develop if you are not healthy. Number three, COVID-19 has shown us that on the final analysis, other than your relationship with the Almighty God, nothing else matters more than health. And then finally, I've written down here, we should teach this even in STEM education, because it is STEM that has made medicine a rational science. I quoted myself here, Martin. Being healthy is fundamental for our happiness and a prerequisite for our ability to pursue our individual and collective aspirations, as well as being able to meaningfully contribute to our personal, our family, our community, and our national progress and development. So health is very important. As if to reiterate that importance of health, if you look at the MDGs that have just passed, world leaders came together and said, look, let us try and find out issues we can raise that would develop the world together. And identify the eight issues covered some of the issues that are listed on the table there. They covered hunger, poverty, education, health was mentioned more than once, environment and partnership. If you look at even the ones we have here, health, yes, that's understandable. But even education, even poverty, even hunger, even environment, all associated with health. So you can find that wherever you go, you must understand that health is a very, very important aspect of human existence, which you have to deal with. Now, health, as we use it, we can be looked at in two forms. We should understand that there are two aspects to it. The first is the common one you and I know about. When we are healthy, when we are ill, we go to a hospital. I've labeled that health care or medical care. That type of care is centered around the patient. It is largely designed to cure an illness. It's usually delivered by a physician or a nurse, and it's institutional. You go to a hospital, you go to a clinic. They give you drugs, they operate on you, they intervene one way or the other. And it is concerned individual well-being. We want the individual to be well. We want the daughter to be well. We want the child to be well. It is always visible. It is in hospitals, it's in clinics. And it has usually strong political promises. This is where the politicians come and tell us, oh, if you let me, I'll build 200 hospitals, I'll build 30 clinics, I'll build that, I'll build that. There is also the other aspect of health, which we call public health. Now, public health is not individual-centered. It is centered on the public. Centered on the public. It is concerned with how a whole lot of people can be well or ill. It is largely preventable. It concerns them largely with preventable issues. The persons looking after public health do not necessarily have to be physicians. A lot of those we have leading the world at the WHO now are not necessarily. It covers a wide ecosystem, looks at the air we breathe, looks at the water we drink, the sanitation around us, the food, the vaccines, and what have you. And it is this aspect of healthcare that is more concerned with improving our life expectancy. If you look at life expectancy, we have been a child that is born in Nigeria today, against a child that is born in Finland today. What are their chances of surviving till they die? That's that a child that is born in Nigeria, about his life expectancy is about 51 years. While a child that is born in Finland, 82, 83, 84. This, it is public health issues as opposed to individual care, in healthcare, that is responsible. Public health is usually not visible except in times of crisis, and therefore it is often poorly funded. If you look at the crisis we have now in the world, it is both a healthcare crisis and a public health crisis. We are struggling with the healthcare crisis because we want to flatten the curve, okay, so that we don't overwhelm our healthcare system. But also, on a wider scale, the humanity is suffering tremendously. Right. Medical science has advanced from its embryonic position to the current state of zero. Important issues. One is the element of research. Research is very important in medicine, indeed, as it is in other subjects. There's been cumulative experience that have grown over time, one upon the other. People have recorded what they have seen, what they have noticed, and so experience has built up. Technology has been very useful to medicine. Technology has been very, very useful. A lot of the advances that are currently in medicine are based on technology. And there have been incremental knowledge because of technology. But of course, we don't forget the role the arts have played. Arts, social sciences, behavioral sciences, culture, there are all issues that have to do with the economics of health, finances, and all that. And of course, most importantly, medical sciences have benefited from interdisciplinary. Several disciplines have come together to make medicine what it is today. And it is because of this coming together of several disciplines that medicine has really advanced the way. In this slide, I tried to put together some time frame for how we can define how advances have occurred in medicine. And it was difficult. However, I actually settled on the fact that the 19th century could be looked upon as a watershed at some a time before the 19th century, events that happened around the 19th century, and events that happened after the 19th century. Let's take them very quickly. People look at prehistoric time up to the commencement of the 19th century. The important thing is that there was very little science then in medicine. Very, very little science. Science, medicine was essentially something that was practiced as a cultural tradition, superstition, more of a magic than any other thing, you know. And it was a family affair. People who felt they knew one type of leaf that did the one thing or the other, they would hide it. Eventually, medicine started to grow, and men of influence came into it. And they were teaching, the men of influence were teaching others. There was no organized form of classroom teaching or what to do. But eventually, the university started coming into it, and description of diseases started coming. And this was how this gentleman, Hippocrates, in the fifth century, wrote the code by which medical practitioners should be. As I said earlier, at that time there was very little science. Science and medicine started coming in later, about that period when universities started teaching, University of Padua, Bologna, Oxford, they then started teaching medicine. And then science started. Then we go to the 19th century. This was the stage in which science came into medicine in a big way. And there were so many inventions, so many advances at that period that I tried to localize one that could be identified as having really made that mark. And it was with a lot of difficulty that I chose this. The microscope is the instrument that came and makes science able to see beyond what it can see, able to see beyond what it can see, using the science of physics, magnification, see items that are beyond us. And this opened a completely new vista in medicine. We were able to see bacteria, we were able to see viruses when the electron microscope was discovered and all that. And therefore, a new aspect of medicine, all public health, all came into being here. And we got to know that quite a number of the diseases we suffer from are infectious. And in order to find these infections, we have to use this big, this microscope. And of course, after the 19th century, we entered the 20th century. The Industrial Revolution has come. A lot of STEM has now come in, not just science now. STEM has come in science, technology, engineering, mathematics have all come in a big way, and medicine was, medical sciences now have a real boost. So you find that a lot of inventions that came in at this period also. And also at that time, politicians started making the market. Agenda 2063 in Africa. The World Health Organization was formed in 1948. Nobel Prize was now instituted. MDGs came, then SDGs. So a lot of advances came, although with respect to prestige. And I thought that education was going to be right until COVID came in 2020 now. And what is becoming clear is that maybe after this, we just partition the whole thing to be a pre-COVID medical science and a post-COVID medical science. COVID is going to bring about a lot of differences in the way we practice medicine and what we do about medical science. That essentially is what I want to say, except that we now take a number of examples to illustrate what we're doing. We're going to take a few examples, look at recent advances in medicine, look at applications that technology has made, look at traditional medicine, and then look at the implications of all this for STEM education. Now, the first I have here has to do with relief. Now, before this time, there was surgery lagged behind very, very, very seriously because you couldn't really perform surgical operations on someone who was feeling that degree of pain. And there was nothing to numb the pain. So in order to do that, some patients were physically restrained in order to have the operated upon. Or some persons were given a lot of alcohol until they went into an alcoholic stupor. And in that stupor, they held them down, they operated on them very quickly. To the extent that the physicians in this did not regard the surgeons as being doctors. They said, look, you couldn't be inflicting such tremendous hardship on patients and then say that they are doctors. No, you are not. Until pain relief, the science of anesthesia came up. And it was really the discovery of dietary diet, which a lot of you have manufactured in the laboratory, that changed the scene. This was in 1846, and this was in Boston, Massachusetts, when William Morton demonstrated that if you give ether to a patient, the patient will sleep, albeit briefly, and you'll be able to quickly do whatever it is you wish to do. Now, at that point, we have here, this is the machine that is currently utilized for anesthesia. I have here a number of anesthetic agents. There is ether, there is inhalation anesthesia. And then I've got here propofol. Propofol is the agent that was given to Michael Jackson. As you know, Michael Jackson received this drug and then he died over a period of time. I also have regional anesthesia here, that's epidural anesthesia, which is to show that anesthesia is not always that you have to put the patient to sleep. You can turn a particular aspect of the body and then have that aspect operated upon. Right. Another worry, big worry we have is that children die. Children tend to die when they're delivered. And there are many, many examples of many children that have died. I have a friend whose parents had 12 children, and he was the only one who survived, 11 died. Hmm. So child mortality was a very, very serious problem. And pediatrics, which is the science of childhood, concerned itself with what shall we do to try and find out how we can reduce childhood mortality. So it found out that children died because of malaria, particularly in our area. Mosquitoes beat them. Their blood, their red blood cells were hemolyzed, they came by the neck and they died. They had diarrheal infections. They had infections that made them have a lot of diarrhea. And they were not feeling well and all that. So they came up with child survival strategies in which they ensured that children now slept under dead mosquito nets. Children that had diarrhea had a mixture of salt and sugar solution given to them. And they were, women were made to breastfeed their children exclusively for a period of 4 to 6 months. And they found that this made a lot of difference. If you look at this, then of course there was the issue of vaccination to prevent diseases. And these are all vaccine preventable diseases here. So this is the package of issues that came up. with digital, it became possible to try and reduce childhood mortality, which we are now enjoying. If you look at this graph here now, this is from the Nigerian Demographic and Health Survey of 2018. And if you look at this graph here, you find that the neonatal mortality, that's dead within the first month of life, infant mortality within the first year of life, and under five mortalities, they're all falling because of the application of these strategies that ensure that babies that are born don't die that quickly. Right, let's go to reproductive health, reproductive medicine. Now, one of the reasons people marry is that they want to have children. And the normal way of having children is that the man and the woman complete. And when they complete, an in vivo conception, the conception that occurs inside the body of the woman, takes place. But sadly, not all marriages result in fertility. Not all marriages result in the ability of women to have children. In some places, up to 70% of such marriages may not produce children. In some cases, 10. And when you find out the causes, you find that quite a bit of the causes are things that you could meet in one way or the other. If you look at the issues on our right here, because doctors have done a lot of to try and deal with the issue of infertility. But the results were not satisfied. Until came these two gentlemen, Robert Edwards and Patrick Skepto, and identify a process called in vitro fertilization and embryo transfer. Big words, but let me explain. You know, we did say that normal conception is an in vivo conception, of course, in the human body. In vitro fertilization or in vitro conception is one that occurs outside the human body. What they did was that they took an egg from the woman, took an egg which is called the ovum, they took an egg from the male, which is, the spermatozoa or spermatozoon and singular, and brought the two of them together in a petri dish, the petri dish that you use in your chemistry lab, your biology lab or whatever. And boy, oh boy, the two united and formed an embryo. When they united and formed an embryo, these two smart germs, now picked up that embryo, which is here now. And with the pipette you use in laboratories, and were able to syringe that embryo through the vagina, through the cervical canal, into the uterine cavity. And that embryo now patched, stuck on into the uterine cavity, and grew. I tried this over and over again, and eventually in 1978, they were able to have a conception. The Louise Brown, as you all know, was the first baby that was born that year. And this was the news, the paper that heralded the birth of Louise Brown. Louise Brown is written a book, 40 years of in vitro. So great was this event that it was described as arrival to man's first on the moon about 9 years ago. Now, in vitro fertilization is everywhere. Now, in Africa, we have about 500, and in Nigeria, we have about 85. So that in vitro fertilization, remember, it is extracorporeal conception occurred outside the human body. And let's go on to imaging. That's another big thing that has happened in medicine, the giant scale of medicine. And here I call it photographing the invisible. How do you photograph something you cannot see? But that's what imaging in science in medicine has done. And then it came accidentally. There was this German, Wilhelm Conrad Röntgen, who was playing with electromagnetic radiation in his palm and discovered that it penetrated skin. Penetrated the skin, was able to see bones. That's him there. You can see it penetrated his skin, and he was able to see his bones reflect on the board. And he felt this was new, and pursued it. And then went and took a photograph of an X-ray of his wife's fingers. These are his wife's fingers. This is her the ring finger with the ring. And the wife has claimed that she has seen her death. That's it. She has seen her death. And of course, this pigeon now went on. So stark was this discovery. It was not surprising that Ranjin won the first Nobel laureate. He was became the first Nobel laureate in physics in 1901. And since then, because technology has come, we now have advanced forms of imaging, computerized tomography, ultrasonography, magnetic resonance. They are all pinpoint accurate. And if you look at these films here now, look at, we're able to see the internal body of this man or lady. We can see her heart here. That's the heart. This is the aortic notch. You can see almost everything here. These are the ribs. You can count the ribs. These are the lungs. They're full of air. That's the diaphragm there. That's the diaphragm. This is the left humerus, the right humerus. This chap here has his bones broken here. So you can see way beyond what your eyes can see by means of an
X-ray. Wonderful. 10 minutes more.
Now here to clap. We are now in back.
Yeah, 10 minutes more, Your Excellency. 10 minutes more, sir. Yes, okay.
Well, here we have vaccines, and this is the end thing now. And the principle of vaccines, the principle of vaccines is based on the fact that God has made us with a system we call the immune system. The immune system consists of organs and antibodies and various aspects of what within our bodies, as you can see here. And they respond in a manner that once they identify a toxic agent, they form some antibodies against that toxic agent. And if they succeed in neutralizing that toxic agent, any other time another toxic agent that is similar or same agent comes in, they will neutralize it also. That's the basis of the immune system. And it is regarded that this is the most important development in global health, 500 years and there more. Right now, so this is now how Edward Jenner, who eventually got vaccine. Vaccine, actually, the Baka is the name of the cow. Baka is the name of a cow. And vaccinia is the disease, cowpox, that people suffer. Now, what is very, very simple. He discovered that maids that looked after cows, who had a very mild form of disease called cowpox, never had smallpox. Smallpox was a very dangerous disease. Look at this baby here. The face covered with smallpox. And many persons died. And even those who didn't die were very badly disfigured. So he felt that there was something in that inside that cowpox that was making the maids not have the smallpox. So he was able to get smallpox material from a maid that had a cowpox. And he inoculated it into a little boy. And that boy now became ill, slight fever, headache, and all that. A couple of people. And now, after about a couple of months, he inoculated him the same thing again, and discovered that the boy didn't eat again at all. And so he felt that this was something that was possible. And he now was able to do that. So that agent is called the antigen. And that agent now invokes an immune response by forming antibodies that neutralize the pathogen the next time the pathogen then comes into our body. So successful antigen is used as a vaccine against various pathogens. Now, if we go on to the technology, contributions of technology, and then technology has given back to technological health revolution, the so-called artificial intelligence, 3D, dimensional printing, nanotechnology, the drones, the internet, you can go on and on. People just take them very quickly. Robots are machines that are made to do the work man used to do, to do work like man. And then we use robots to carry out very extensive surgeries. Probably the most important and most well-known is robot-assisted radical prostatectomy. Prior to this, prostatectomy that is removing a prostate that is either diseased or big or whatever, used to be a very bloody operation and took a long time. Now, by means of these instruments assisted by the robot, this operation, this is both abdominal distension, these surgeries are carried out in a painless manner, in a shorter period, amount of blood loss is much less, and then hospitalization is also much less. If you go to artificial intelligence, these are machines that are now made to think like man, and they're utilized in telehealth, in imaging, with patients, about keeping retrieval, drug interruptions, and all of that. Again, if we move on to 3D printing, 3D printing is a science that goes outside medicine, but medicine since incorporated it and is utilizing it to print liver, to print heart, to print prosthesis. Now, these are things that are utilized even for transplantations now, let alone the fact that they are utilized for a lot of research in the area. Right? Of course, the internet. What we have done without the internet? The internet is of vital to the patient, the doctor, to the family, to the community. It enables the doctor, the patient to understand his or her disease better. The patient that is able to understand his or her disease is a better, it's always a better material to deal with. The smartphones are there, the wearable sensors, multiple appliances. The internet has played a very major role in the advance of medicine, the primary, secondary, and tertiary level, even outside. Nanotechnology in medicine. Nano, as you know, is 1/1,000,000,000 of anything you are talking about. And these are particles that are even smaller than the virus. And then particularly nanotechnology has enabled medicine to make incursions into DNA manipulations so that treatment, surgeries are directed directly to individuals as opposed to things that are done in the wider manner. These are all the areas in which nanotechnology is now coming. Drones have been very useful in our supply chain deliveries. We use drones to send compatible blood from one place
three
to
minutes,
another.
Three minutes.
Okay. Yeah. We thank Ghana and Rwanda for taking the lead in these areas. This is talking about the NHS at 70. But let's just spend the next minute or two of traditional medicine. It's not only in Western medicine, if you want to call it that, that advances have been made. We also have our traditional system of medicine, but sadly, this has not been developed. And the presence of good traditional medicine is one important fact that assures us that we had a very strong indigenous knowledge. But this has not been developed satisfactorily. These are diseases that we have. Kwashiorkor is a condition which we know that a child has when a new one is coming. Women believe that it is because the child is not having enough, and they turn the child upside down like this and try to feed the child in this manner. Our traditional medicines have been used, most of us here have had one form of traditional medicine, like malaria, sickle cell disease. This is a drug that I've accepted as being good, even WHO, diabetes. These are all, here we have a list of drugs, diseases that could be treated with traditional medicine. And of course, you know, the current COVID-19 Madagascar issue that is looking on. Now, the reasons for the lagging behind of traditional medical care is all stated here. But there's some silver line in the cloud, which is that WHO now recognizes that traditional medicine is real. The WHO Afro on the 31st of August every year sets aside for celebration of our traditional medicine. Africa will want to emphasize this place of traditional medicine. The OAU has given instructions to its medical organs that traditional medicine was supposed to. Africa Centers of Excellence, University of Lagos now has the Herbal Medicine Center. You can go on and on and on. Right, these are some implications. And right now, what is the implication for STEM education? We made a statement at the beginning that health is a fundamental requirement. Number one resource and capital, and that nothing matters on the final analysis of health. And that health is too important to be left to medicine alone. Health is too important to be left to medicine. If that is so, then STEM education cannot be complete without a thorough grasp of the place of health and humaneness in the context of human affairs. STEM must teach the rudiments of health and humaneness as critical and strategic elements in science education. And STEM must teach that everyone must take some responsibility for his or her health, as well as that of the community, as civic responsibility instead of his or her goal. Right. In conclusion, whether that COVID-19 has shown that at no time is the issue of health, which incidentally is a developmental strategy, which advancement rests on medical science and humaneness, stacker than it is in times of crisis and despair, such as we have now. STEM education must therefore espouse and propagate the fundamental position that health and medical sciences occupy in the affairs of man as part of the essential nature of science. Science is very essential. Which matters science essential, it matters. And which the world must have, the world needs science, and it must have science if it is to survive. Furthermore, STEM education must give vent to the enormous healing powers of traditional native plants and herbs of indigenous communities, especially those in Africa, and integrate them into the mainstream of science to advance the quality of life and encourage the development of indigenous people.
Thank you so very much, Professor Nimi Briggs. I tell you, I've not seen a lecture as rich and as comprehensive as this. You may wish to unshare your screen, sir. I've not seen a lecture in medicine that has broadened my horizon of knowledge as this. You may wish to unshare your screen, sir.
I'm trying to.
Trying to unshare you.
You can unshare me.
No, I can't. I've done so, but you have to. You have yourself now. Now, I'd like to ask all of us, to give a warm round of applause to Professor Nimi Briggs for this very rich, very comprehensive exposition. When I grow up, I want to go and read medicine. I can see Professor Femi Jayola from Portland, Oregon. We have a large, let me just say, yes. Stamenka is east of, okay. So we have about 6 minutes to interact with Professor Nimi Briggs. I would like to begin, though, by just reflecting with him. He has given us the reason why STEM education should regard medicine as partner, and how STEM education can contribute towards improvement in the medical capacity that we have in every country. But you see, sir, I'm working with a couple of people. We are getting a report for Africa on how you can make population an asset. Africa's population that's increasing, how we can make it an asset. And one major enabler is healthcare. What we have found, just give me a minute, sir. Yeah, what we have found is that in almost all African countries, the government gives very little attention to healthcare. Go to hospitals in Ghana, in Burundi, in Nigeria, everywhere. You see that we are poorly, poorly resourced. So, sorry, Adewale, you are. Let's have some quiet everywhere, please. Yeah, so there's a challenge that African governments have. You can see all the wonderful things that you have listed as development in, like, orthodox, Western science. And even in the traditional one, you've given the obstacles there. So I have some challenge in my mind about whether African leaders really care much about the health of their people in terms of investment in health. Okay, so the floor is open again. Yola Dejo, I've seen a hand as saying Bugoma. David, just a minute now. Bugoma, David, Ola Dejo. Fred, did you raise your hand? Okay, I'm afraid. I think we'll just stop with those four. And what we're going to do, Femi, okay, we have Femi. So what we're going to do is, because of constraint of time, when you take the floor, make your intervention to be brief. And then I'm going to kindly ask Professor Nimi Briggs to also, be brief in his response to our questions. Femi, take the floor. Femi, Generola, take the floor.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for the wonderful lecture and good morning, sir. Sir, just this morning I was reading in the headlines that the federal government has slashed the primary health care fund from 44 billion to 25 billion naira. So, and also for education. And considering all what you have said about the recent development in STEM education in this country, sir, where are we going?
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Femi. Femi has agreed with what I've just said. Let me mute everybody again. There's some noise from some quarters. So if you want to take the floor, please just unmute yourself. Yeah, that's it. So that's what I've just said, Femi, regarding lip service to healthcare, lip service to education. So the data that I have, we have data, like you know, Femi, our group, we have data for all African countries in terms of how much they are spending on health, and it's just a pittance. All right. So we take Fred, and then Oladejo, and David, and then Bugoma. So ladies will come last this time.
Hello?
So Fred, take the floor. Fred.
Thank you very. Okay, I'm here, sir.
Yes.
Thank you very much, Prof. I'm interested in the intro. I think it's the
in vitro.
IVF. What are the
in
major
vitro?
In vitro fertilization. What are the major causes of failure in Africa?
All right, that's very good. Thank you very much.
That's it.
Thank you. Oladejo, take the floor.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, Professor, for the lecture. My issue is this, sir. How do we balance the equation between mental health and the rigorous requirements of a master's or a doctoral study? We have heard that it is advised to sleep for 6 or 8 hours. Yet you want to study. Our professors who are teaching us will even take some drugs to sleep so they can study very well and not disappoint themselves, their parents, and their teachers. How do we balance the issue of mental health? Thank you, sir.
All right. We take care. That's another job. Before David, let me tell you a story, a true story. I used to have a senior while I was in secondary school in St. Malachi's College in Sapele. Now, senior Agu will drink almost a tin of Nescafe, whole tin of Nescafe in a week. He will drink the thing, no sleep. He will put his leg in the bucket of water while he's reading for prep, night prep. Now, when the results came out, SSC, Senior Agu got 999, F9, all the way through. So that's on the side, but that's a true story. So David, take the floor. David.
Yeah, thank you, Professor, for the floor, and thank you for the presentation. In STEM education, we agree to use indigenous knowledge for STEM education.
Yes.
Why now? Nowadays, scientists and medicine are against traditional medicine.
That's a very good question. So the last is Bugoma, Dr. Bugoma. So please take the floor.
Thank you, Professor, for the floor. So my question was, it's like, it has nuance with a David question. It's like, it's about traditional medicine. Because COVID-19 has shown us the importance of good health care system. But also in Africa, we don't have that good health care system education. And many suggestions were that we should go and see how traditional medicine can help us to respond, like to have a quick response. So my point is like, this is Afrocentrism in medical science.
Yes.
Or against this Afrocentrism in medical science.
Excellent. So Professor Nimi Briggs, you have the floor, sir, to just in about 2 minutes, if you don't mind, sir, just respond quickly.
Mr. Chairman, the issues that were raised, the issues that I raised usually in every discussion such as this, one is that the very poor attention that is paid to healthcare by African countries. That is a shame. And if you remember what happened in Nigeria, when COVID-19 started, the leader of the Nigerian COVID-19 team made a statement that he did not know until now.
Exactly.
That health is so poor.
He said so. Yeah.
And then it was then that they were rushing around to do this, do that. Each state governor, whenever he or she came onto the thing, he would say that they are now realized how neglected the health service system had been, and that thereafter they would do this, they would do that. That's what it's been. You remember I did tell you that the health sector is you can look at it from two aspects. One is the aspect that is curative, essentially, we have buildings and health clinics, hospitals, or whatever. The politicians always will come and tell you that they will build that, and they never do. And even when they do, they don't take care of them. There are no drugs in them.
Yes.
The bigger issue of what we have seen is the air we breathe. I mean, the air we breathe, how
good is the water we drink and all that. They don't address them.
No.
So these issues that African leaders, one is hoping that COVID-19 would have taught us lessons of our life that would be better hereafter. And reduction in health budget. It's the same that they give a pittance. A lot of the budget goes into the expenditure by the rulers in their emergency budgets, and the budget given to health care is very little, very, very little. IVF, what is the cause of the failure? Are you asking of failure of fertility ab initio? That is, why is it that a good number of marriages are not fertile? Or are you asking for, let me ask both of them, failure of IVF? A lot of relationship marriages here, quite a number of them are not successful because there has been some pathology in the tubes, in the fallopian tubes.
Sure.
The tubes which the woman came to the marriage with. Even the man too, there are problems in one third of the women. I mean, one third of the problems are women, one third of the problems are men, and the other one third we don't have any of the cause. So irrespective of what the cause is, that process of conception could be bypassed. And then the conception can be made to take place in the tube, in the petri dish, and then the embryo transplant. As for failure of IVF itself, everything practice makes perfect. I told you now that in every country, in Ghana, we have a lot of IVF centers that are quite successful. In Nigeria, we have, even in Port Harcourt here, we have three that are functioning perfectly well now. One in fact, incidentally, it was when I was in charge of the National Hospital of Abuja that we were the first to do IVF in a public hospital in Nigeria.
Wow.
And so failure is not necessarily too bad as far as we're concerned. How do you balance sleeping and working hard? It's for you to decide. By the time you come to do good work, you would have known what works for you and what doesn't work for you. If you spend all your time sleeping, you're indolent, you probably would not as well. But all the same, you don't as the director said, it's not by the amount of time you spend with your legs in the pocket that you are able to apportion your time satisfactorily. Scientific medicine or traditional medicine. Traditional medicine, if you do is that slide, fortunately you have access to the slide. That slide you will see where we discuss where traditional medicine has not done well. That's all. One is that the element of research has not been applied onto it satisfactorily. Some of the claims that are made by traditional practitioners are bogus. Who claim that one drug will cure every single problem in a human being, that's not true. But these drugs are not enumerated. The components of what you are taking is not known. There's no dosage to it. There are many reasons. And of course, we too have our bias against traditional. But again, this is now, I did indicate that the people are in the now, and that things should be improvement for the better. I think those are all the questions we have.
Wonderful. Thank you so very much, sir. Professor Nimi Briggs. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, let us appreciate Professor Nimi Briggs for the exciting exposition. Now, we are going to change our mode. You recall that today, unlike other days where we used to have just one special guest, today we had two special guests, Minister of Higher Education from Burundi and the Senior Special Advisor to the Council for Higher Education Accreditation, and a global person in quality assurance from UNESCO, Stamenka Ubadi-Strombich. Now we are reversing again by saying that we will get, you know, there's this expression, Bugoma was talking about Afrocentrism, that in Africa, we used to say that it is the, when the rabbit is big, when the rabbit is big and old, the rabbit will not depend on the child to drink milk. So we depend on our children. So from now on, we are going to be getting our students to make presentations to our facilitators. So for today, Bugoma Suwadu will present the plaque to Professor Nimi Briggs, and then when we have that of Professor Uche Nanzewi, we'll get a man Kuli Oladejo to present to her. So, ladies and gentlemen, we have listened to a very exciting lecture. So it's now my pleasure to invite Bugoma Suwadu, Dr. Bugoma Suwadu from Burundi, to make this presentation on our behalf. Bugoma, you have the floor.
Thank you, Professor. Lagos State University, Africa Center of Excellence for Innovative and Transformative STEM Education, a world-bound project, this is to certify that Emeritus Professor Nimi Briggs facilitated courses AC812 and AC912 June 1st to 6th, 2020, signed by distinguished Professor Peter Okebukola, Director, on behalf of LASSO ASSET Center of Excellence.
Thank you so very much. Again, Professor Nimi Briggs, we can't thank you enough. You know, you go down in history as a leader, as someone who has mentored quite a lot of us, a lot of persons. And by the time we are launching, please note, Professor Nimi Briggs, about the middle of July, we'll be launching the virtual library of the University of Burundi, Doctoral School, and the University of Burundi virtual library. You are going to be one of the people that will be there. So that brings us to the end of the lecture by our Emeritus Professor Nimi Briggs. Once again, let's give him another round of applause. Thank you. Yeah, that's good.